What's up, everybody? It's Keefe from Ghost Cult, Ghost Cult Magazine, ghostcultmag.com. We're here at the studio of Vincent Castiglia, world-renowned artist, tattoo artist, and we're going to talk about his new exhibit, Sanguine Spring, at the Salem Art Gallery at the Satanic Temple in Salem, Massachusetts. We're going to discuss his career and his work and music and a whole bunch of other stuff. So thank you for your time, Vincent. It's great
thank
to be
you.
Here.
Thank you
so much,
Keith,
for spending some time with us. Let's talk about the exhibit. I definitely wanted to jump in and discuss, we talked a little bit before about the concept and the gallery itself and, you know, what drew you to this concept. So let's jump in there.
Yeah, the name of the show is obviously Since Sanguine Spring, and it's based on an ancient Roman practice. There are a few, one is called Lupercalia, the other Parentalia. It was a kind of ritualized observance of bloodletting and excess and a kind of sweeping away of the vestiges of winter and preparing for spring. And it was a concept that the temple had presented to me, and you know, really was just like perfectly in line with the work and really essentially where the work is coming from anyway. So
great. For those not familiar, the exhibit opened in February and is still running, I believe, through the spring. And let's talk about, I've seen a few of the pieces, but I know there's some very defined ones I'm sure you want to speak to, the sculpture, and some of the other stuff.
Yeah, it's a retrospective, so it's all existing work, and it's a mix of original painting, limited edition prints, large format, gigue, and sculpture. Actually, my biggest original painting in the that exists is in the show. It's called Stings of the Lash. It's kind of the centerpiece, and there are other large works, Duality, and several others for original paintings. And the sculpture in the show is called Blood from a Stone. It is a self-portrait, but the concept was, you know, you can't get blood from a stone. Well, allegorically I did, in the sense that by submitting my essence and my actual vital fluid, I've kind of broken an allegorical mold.
Nice. And for those not familiar with Vincent's work, Vincent uses blood in his work. I know there's been a lot of discussion about the blood use in your work, phlebotomy and, you know, mixing the blood of other artists for pieces you've done for people. So I know for the sculpture, you know, it literally looks like tears of blood.
Yeah.
And it didn't occur to me that it was based on you, so that's great. Yeah. What was your basis? Did you use photography of yourself? You know, just know yourself, mirrors? How did you go about that piece?
The way I made that piece was, initially there was a life cast done three times. It drooped three times when it was drying, and ended up looking completely distorted. So on the third attempt, I didn't want to waste this material, and I had already committed to the project. And I chiseled the whole thing down, and I sculpted it with my hand. And then a cast was made of that sculpture, and then that's how that was produced. It was made with hydrocal, real human blood, iron oxide, and epoxy to seal it.
Awesome. And I know that you you mentioned the collaborative process kind of about creating the show, and your work has been exhibited all over the world in incredible galleries. I meant to say or ask, did you have a hand in, you know, obviously if it's your show and it's in their gallery, was it a collaborative process of, you know, arranging the exhibit, or did you kind of just submit the pieces and leave it to them?
They told me whatever you would like to put in the show is completely fine, so the selection, the curation was mine. The actual installation they would handle with a little bit of you know, information from me about some preferences, and they just did a, you know, phenomenal job. It's really, I thought it was really well done.
Yeah, great. I've always been a fan of how grounded in realism your work is, and again, not just that the blood itself is very visceral as a material, but also, you know, again, really lends itself into each piece. And that's what I mean to say is the blood on the sculpture, the blood in the pieces. Can you speak a little bit to that specifically for this exhibit, as, you know, in the context of your overall work?
The motivation or inspiration for using the medium, it remains pretty much constant. There is a special something to working with it that is not present with other materials and other media, and I've worked in essentially all other media. It is not only a sacrifice, a very literal physical one, but something comes forth that I believe is an energetic thing. You know, like you could call it psychic energy, however you want to view it. But once I started working with the blood prior to having had work with it, I just fell in love. It was like there for the first time that this personal truth was communicated by the substance, and it was the completion of a kind of conceptual circle. Blood is usually seen only when someone is injured, and very, very literally, it was a catharsis at the time when I started working with it, and it was real. It was a release valve, as crazy as that might sound, but something beautiful was born. And when I say beautiful, it's, the images themselves might be horrific or maybe not so beautiful to some people, but transmuting the raw materials of circumstance and the elements of my life and the energies at play at the time into something cohesive and intelligent and forward moving. And they in that way become a kind of a guidance, and the way I look at it, the body of work becomes a kind of ethereal roadmap, because the compositions themselves, again, are really about where I'm at the time and the energies at play, and sincerely pouring that stuff out, I get a glimpse into myself and into my psyche in a way that is not possible by any other means. And the 1-2 combination here that just makes it so kind of intense for me is the fact that I'm literally translating flesh, because blood is technically considered tissue. I'm translating tissue into a piece of artwork. And, some schools of thought would call it a piece of living artwork. It has a vitality to it. And they're human figures that are rendering with human blood.
Does it occur to you when you're thinking of a concept to either this thing might lend itself to a sculpture, this is a sketch, this is a painting? How does that process work for you? Is it as piece by piece, or?
Yeah, I mean, for the most part, they are paintings. I'm getting into sculpture now. There are several things in the works. But the way an image, there are two ways an image occurs to me. And it's either spontaneous and visionary, essentially, and I'll have
an image that pops into my head, and it's essentially the congealing of again the essences of what's going on at the time, either internally or externally, or a combination of both. That's one way. The other way is when a concept is significant enough to me to inspire a painting, and it's more of a planned out, less automatic type of drawing and conceptual process.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing. And in terms of this show, when this show is over, is this an installation you think can travel somewhere else, or do you do sort of a one-time, very exclusive installation or engagement and then transfer it somewhere else? Is that possible, or do you move on to the next concept?
In some instances, a show will travel.
My show from the H.R. Giger Museum in Switzerland traveled to the Museum of Porn and Art. So that's something that has happened before, but for this particular show, it was a one-time combination of selection of paintings.
So while we're here in your studio talking about your work and your career and your installation, I have to call attention to this incredible piece behind us. Do you mind just taking us through this piece and some of your more recent work?
Absolutely.
This is the title piece in my current body of work called Autopsy of the Soul. And the concept is, you know, in our world today, I feel like there is a kind of death of all things creative. It's a kind of examination of the world's soul. We're not talking about anything religious or anything like that, but the figure is being autopsied, so its chest is being cut open, and its essence is escaping and being collected by this imaginary, this fantastic contraption, which is translating, it's transmuting this essence into a kind of liquid. And it's being weighed by these two scales. And it's an ancient Egyptian concept. After, you know, death, your deeds are weighed, your heart is weighed against the feather. And if your heart is lighter than the feather, you're granted access to the afterlife or the underworld, or, you know, however it goes. And it was something that resonated with me, really, because there is such a disproportion of many things in this world at this point, and it's as if the species is vastly asleep. And I painted another piece that dealt with that concept, which is the sleep. It's a kind of hopeful piece in that maybe we can weigh out and examine our assets and liabilities as a species now and start progressing. And it's an all-encompassing statement, but I see it most in creative fields, because that's what I do, and, you know, music and art and film and so forth. But just there's so many platforms that lack a heartbeat in a soul. You know, it's contrived. You know, the least common denominator of everything. You know, on the radio, you can't tell what's the difference between one artist or another, because there's so much derivation everywhere, and formula. Everything is formulaic. What's going to sell the most is what gets promoted the most, and that formula kept dumbing itself down to the dumbest, lowest common denominator, which is 2017. And where do we go from here? So it's a kind of assessment of the assets and liabilities of our species. It's a lofty thought. The figure is dead. Because the illustration or the implication is that the world's soul is like dead at the moment. And that's not to say that, you know, another can't be born. You know, and I think that's what just happened. When I speak about a pendulum swing, you know, there's a lot of change going on in the world. And it'll be a trickle-down effect, I think, because the veneer of bullshit is cracked. You know, fatally cracked, and people are seeing through the bullshit and maybe starting to think for themselves, and I think that's when some cool stuff can happen.
Truly, and it's always art and music that really reveals, is that mirror up to society and shows the next thing, and luckily we have artists and musicians to look up to. And it's interesting that death figures a lot prominently in your work, because life does too, not just with the blood, but obviously, you know, these concepts of the soul and the afterlife, I think these are very finite but also vast thoughts. And how did you sort of get on this path of talking about all these topics and expressing them through your work?
Well, first I'd like to say I am not religious in any sense. Having read a lot, and, you know, again, that's where my head's been for a lot of years. The work is informed by a lot of science. Science and mysticism are essentially what my bookshelf are. If you look at my bookshelf, it's like the esoteric and then physics section out of Barnes & Noble. It's pretty one or two track, I should say. So that really is where the work is coming from and what's embodied in it. And I entertain pretty complicated notions about that stuff, and they are devoid of any dogma whatsoever. But the fact of the matter is, energy cannot be created or destroyed. It's the first law of thermodynamics. The second law is the law of entropy, which is that energy can only be transformed from available to unavailable. So whether the body dies, you know, we're all going to die. there is a certain amount of energy that was us that is still there. So that interests me tremendously. And what form it may take, where it may go, I'm not thinking or speaking in terms of obviously a heaven or hell, but nor a purgatory.
I'm really glad you mentioned Giger before, because I really wanted to discuss Giger with you, H.R. Giger. For those that don't know, Vincent was the first American artist ever featured at the Giger in the show in Switzerland, the Giger Museum. And I feel like you're one of the few artists in the world that really captures that aesthetic that he had and his followers have had, and you've tattooed some Giger work, and obviously your musical contributions to album artwork like Triptychon. We know that Thomas Gabriel Fisher is hugely was close friends with Giger. So I definitely wanted to get you to discuss a little bit of your attraction to Giger and how he figures into your work.
Absolutely. Giger was like my art hero. He was. I grew up required by Giger's work, buying his books, buying his posters, and all that. Then having met him, it was in 2005 I was invited to an exhibition of Giger's by a mutual friend. And there he saw my work for the first time. And it was in 2006, it was a show organized by the Society for Art of Imagination, and I showed two pieces in the museum. That's where he saw it in person for the first time, and it was shortly thereafter that we discussed the solo exhibition. You know, to have met Giger was mind-blowing, and then to have had this tremendous honor, it was like I could have died then and been good with it.
You really captured that the aesthetic that he was trying to present as well, and it does come through in some of your musical work, your artwork for bands and other things, some of your commissioned pieces I've seen too. So if you want to talk about, not just, you mentioned the profound influence he had on the impact, and I see it was a loss losing him, and his work lives on a lot of music and art and film, which is very fortunate for us.
For sure. Tom also is a great friend. And, you know, they're doing some great things, Triptychon still. It's unfortunate that, you know, a lot of European bands are really limited in their travel these days, given the U.S. restrictions, the visas, and stuff like that. But hopefully we'll be seeing more of Triptychon here in the future.
You know, in a modern sense, we see artists crossing over into other avenues, and it has to be pretty surreal to get to work with a Thomas Gabriel Fisher of Triptychon and Celtic Frost, of Gary Holt of Slayer and Exodus on the Gary Holt blood guitar with Gary's blood. And
sure.
I know a lot has been talked about that, and you've answered a lot of questions about that, but
yeah.
As a person, you had a musical background as well as an art background, and so I just have to ask about, like, was it kind of a little trippy and mind-blowing to meet those guys and become, have associates, you know, become friends with them?
Absolutely.
As well as work for them?
Yeah, the answer is yes, and it's been, you know, just a tremendous honor to work with Tom and the Gary Holt guitar. Translating his blood into a functional piece of artwork that then he can communicate his life's work, it's just a kind of, it's a very surreal thing to me. It's alchemy at its finest, translating something that's usually associated with blood, with spatter, and into a concrete, finely rendered and tailored piece of original artwork that is, again, a functional instrument. And again, working with Gary and Slayer, I mean, I grew up on Slayer, man. That was my first show ever, was at Roseland Ballroom, Slayer, Machine Head, and Biohazard, Roseland Ballroom, I don't know, fucking 94, 94. 4 or 5 or
Divine
something like that. Yeah, it was a Divine Intervention tour.
And the first Machine Head record was out, and I was at the show as well.
Yeah, and the place was coming down. It was getting ripped apart. And I was just like, you know, it was my scene. So
Machine Head was the first band I ever saw not get booed opening for Slayer.
Right.
And it was like my third or fourth time seeing them. So, yeah, and amazing. And not just to say that again, you know, Thomas Gabriel Fischer is one of the architects of heavy and interesting music. And
for sure.
One of the greatest writers ever. Gary is one of the architects of thrash metal, one of the greatest guitar players and guys in the whole world. And
for sure.
Is also.
Yes. So both of them are.
Just amazing for you. And let's just take another step into music as part of your process. We're listening to this and chanting music behind us. I know that you work with music on, whether you're tattooing, if you can, or creating. What kind of music do you enjoy, besides, you know, speak about what we're hearing and other music you like yourself?
You know, man, my musical preferences are like across the board completely. I listen to some bizarre shit. Aside from what you would imagine, which is, you know, metal and rock and so forth, I listen to a lot of ambient and ethereal music. I listen to a decent amount of chant, some improv, you know, certain forms of jazz fusion, and dark wave.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah, I got a soft spot for the dark wave. Yeah, but and a bunch of other things in between, but it really depends on my mood. It depends on what mood I want to be in, and what I'm doing. But there really is not a point over the course of a day that I'm not listening to music if I can help it, because life is just so much better with it.
It sure is. Do you have a bucket list musical artist you would love to create a piece for, or an album art for, or an instrument for?
You know, I don't offhand. I mean, I hadn't really thought about that, but you know, Metallica would probably be on the top of that list. You know, like a Kirk Hammett or James Hetfield. You know, they were a big part of my getting into metal.
Yeah, apparently Lars Ulrich was quite the art collector at one point. Owned quite a lot of Basquiat's and Warhol's. So
I've heard that actually.
What to do with your money, Lars? If you're watching this. Commission this man, maybe next Metallica album, apparently. Yeah, that's awesome. You know, just, you know, things that interest me about you as well. And just as we wind this down, I know you have some appearances coming up. You keep a very stout schedule, so we're really grateful for your time here today. I know
so
you have
welcome,
a convention
man.
Coming up.
Yep.
I'm sure you'd like to promote.
Absolutely.
Your appearance at.
Yeah, I was invited to the United Inc. convention at Resort World Casino. It's March 31st, April 1st, and 2nd. They'll also be doing an exhibition of my paintings, so I'm there. I'm booked all weekend tattooing, but there will be an installation of paintings of originals and large format prints the whole weekend, so anyone interested in checking it out, come down. Also, after that show, I fly directly to Switzerland for the Ink Days show out there, and that'll be in Zurich, first week of April. I think I have one or two slots left for that show. I'll be back in May.
Terrific. Vincent Castiglia, thank you so much for your time. Spending
so
time
welcome,
with Ghost
man.
Cult Magazine. I'm Keefe, Ghost Cult Mag, ghostcultmag.com. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, man. All right.
Thank you.
You got it, brother.
So we're still talking with Vincent Castiglia. Let's talk about this documentary that's being made about you and your career. I'm really interested to hear about it and how that's going so far.
Yeah, the name of the film is Bloodlines, and it's being directed by John Borowski, a filmmaker from Chicago. He's best known for serial killer documentaries that he's done on H.H. Holmes, Carl Panzram, and several others. They've been streaming on Netflix for a couple of years. And the project is coming to an end now. We're wrapping up. John is in post-production. And, you know, we'll see. We'll see what it looks like. I'm excited, and I'm also anxious. It's really, you know, I'm just bearing my soul. There'll be interviews with collectors of mine, you know, Greg Allman, Gary Holt, Tom Warrior, Kerry King. So it'll be an interesting mix. And it'll be out this year at some point. We don't have a release date yet.
Okay, great. We'll be looking out for that. And I understand you have several of the works coming along soon for people to buy, a sculpture series you're doing, and a pendant. So let's talk a little bit about those things.
Sure. The pendant is out already. It is a reproduction of The Sleep. It's a painting of mine from 2006. And it's a limited edition pendant, sterling silver again. It's available through intenebrisbyjs.com. And there's also a forthcoming sculpture series, the first of which is also going to be The Sleep. And that will be within the next few months. Also a limited edition, very limited, and I'm excited about that.
So if you wanted to get your hands on some Vincent Castiglia artwork and you couldn't until now, these might be some options for you folks coming soon. Again, check his website, check the website he mentioned. There'll be links in the post here as well.